Welcome back to the channel, everyone. This is Michael yet again, and as always, thank you all for joining me today. You would not believe, ladies and gentlemen, how many instant messages I've got, how many personal messages I got, emails from people asking, where the hell are you, man? Why haven't you discussed this film yet? You're a big fan of monster movies, right? What's going on? Why aren't you saying anything? You must have hated this movie. Well, I can put that to bed already, everyone. I haven't discussed the film yet, and it had nothing to do about hating the film. I didn't hate the film. But I will just say that, you know, outside forces affecting my life, such as work, family. I got a little bit down in the dumps, everyone, with the routine, the monotony of life, and I just, you know, just now getting around to talking about this film. Now, as you all know, I'm a big monster movie fan. I love King Kong. I love Godzilla. But it didn't take a rocket scientist for me to realize that, you know, the outcome of this movie was going to be pretty predictable because, let's just admit it, everybody, Godzilla would wipe the fucking floor with King Kong. And no disrespect to King Kong at all, because I love King Kong. But in the grand scheme of things, Godzilla, as was said in the 1962 original film, Godzilla is sheer brute force. And it's like Kong fighting a tornado, an earthquake, a tidal wave. Godzilla is a force of nature, and every inevitable battle between man and the earth, Mother Nature is going to fucking win each time. And Godzilla is no exception. So I knew going into this that, you know, Kong would probably put up a good fight, but at the end of the day, he's just outmatched. Godzilla is just too powerful. Now, with that said, I would say that Godzilla vs. Kong is a movie that centers around King Kong. The movie does really humanize this creature. And that's a good thing, because it's really a stroke of genius the way the filmmakers approach this in terms of, hey, we know that Godzilla's going to beat Kong, but what can we do with Kong to endear him upon the audience? We love Kong too. We love Godzilla. And we don't want to depict either of these characters in a bad way. We want to show honor in both these characters because people love both these characters. And the way they humanized Kong and endeared him to the audience was a stroke of genius. I've always loved King Kong. I've always thought of him as more than a monster, but this film really humanized this character in that I really felt a connection with him. And adding the little girl, Gia, as a direct line of communication to Kong even made this creature more endearing. And by the way, I really did love Gia as a character. I kind of viewed her as kind of a human connection to Kong, whereas she was pure of heart. She was a really sensible and sincere, pure of heart character. And she was like a mirror of what Kong was. So I really did like that relationship. I really did like this little girl in the film. She was just a darling, just a darling of a character. And I really did enjoy her. I enjoyed that relationship between her and Kong. And she, like Kong, had they possessed an innocence that endeared them to me more. I really did like the way Kong was portrayed in this movie. I really did. And that even made the battle between Godzilla and Kong, which I knew was coming, a little bit more heartfelt, in that, like I said, I knew Kong was going to go down, and that really made it harder to watch because, say what you want to say, Kong is he's got a lot of heart, and he's the underdog. So it's not hard to root for him. Now, with that said, guys, first viewing of this film, as I said, I've seen it twice. I would say that it went along at a good pace. Overall, after this film ended, I felt that It pretty much delivered what it promised. You know, when you have a film called Godzilla vs. Kong, you're going into it to see Godzilla fight Kong. And, you know, Godzilla isn't called the king of monsters for nothing. I mean, this creature, to me, is pretty much unbeatable. And even when he does take damage, he has self-healing. He heals almost, you know, immediately. So there's just... there's very, very few monsters that can match Godzilla in sheer brute force. And unfortunately, Kong is not one of those animals. Now, what I will say about the film, as much as I enjoyed it, which I enjoyed it the first time I watched it, but the second time I even enjoyed it more because I kind of knew what was coming, so it just went by a lot faster. I did like some of the science in the film as far as the Hollow Earth thing. I thought it was a really interesting concept. It was something that I hadn't seen before. I don't even know if it's a real thing or not, but I kind of just thought in terms of science fiction, this was something that I hadn't seen before, and that was really kind of interesting because I always, you know, in film, if there's something that hasn't been done before, I'm always kind of a fan of it. And I really liked the Hollow Earth idea. I thought it was really interesting. Unfortunately, we don't learn much about it in the film, but I can only I know it's been spoken of in mostly all of the legendary MonsterVerse films. It's been mentioned, and it's kind of nice to see it. But, you know, the way it stands now is that we really know nothing about it. But I'm going to assume that it's going to be focused on in a further film, and maybe we'll learn more of the mechanics of how it works and all that. Now, with that said, interesting concept, the... Hollow Earth thing, but I don't know, and I don't feel like it was executed very well, because as much as I love Kong as a character, when they got to that point in the movie kind of went dead stop. I kind of felt like they spent too much time getting to where they needed to go with that. I like the wrap up when they, you know, got to the end of that, the Hollow Earth scenes before they went back up to the world. I like that part, but the whole, you know, figuring out Kong, where his ancestry came from and all that, it did really slow down the film. And I got to say that, you know, the Hollow Earth thing opens up more questions than it answers. I mean, you know, you have Kong's existence there, his people's existence there. Who built all this stuff? What happened to them? Was it man-made? Did the creatures build it? There's just a lot of questions to be had there. But on the flip side of that, you know, as a monster movie fan, one of the things that we really don't get is, and this is kind of strange, but we actually got some development on King Kong. I mean, they actually, is this kind of strange? They actually developed a monster character? That's really kind of weird, because you don't think of character development on monsters. And in that respect, King Kong is developed more than the characters in the film. But anyway, so it's kind of a mixed bag for me. I think that the film kind of slowed to a crawl during the Hollow Earth scenes, and I felt like it could have been sped up quite a bit. But at the same time, I mean, it was kind of interesting to learn things about Kong. And, you know, you get to this point where Kong is just such a sympathetic character. He just wants to go home. He wants to be left alone. He doesn't want to be the last of his kind. He wants to see his people. And it's just, you know, you knew he wasn't going to find any of his people in there. And it's just kind of heartbreaking for the character. You really felt badly for this character. Couldn't they have just put in one gorilla in there for him to have some kind of relationship and not be alone? You know, Godzilla probably could give a rat's ass about being alone, but Kong, you know, he wants his people. He wants to be around more of his kind. So that would have been nice if they'd done that. But anyway, when I saw King of the Monsters, a lot of people said that the characters really kind of sucked in that film, and I didn't agree. I thought the characters were fine. I thought they did their job. I mean, you know, I know that, you know, maybe this is a cop out, but actually, you know, in giant monster films, dating all the way back to the Toho Godzilla films, a lot of the times the characters just were essential to move the story along. I mean, you've got to have human characters, and these pretty much move the story along. I didn't mind the characters. I didn't mind them at all. I mean, if I had made the movie, I probably would not have included the podcast character. I know a lot of people really liked him, but I just found him, you know, for the most part, unfunny. And I really feel like he didn't really add a lot to the film at all. I like Millie Bobby Brown, but I would have rather, if I had made the film myself, I would have put her in with the scientists on Skull Island and made her part of that crew, and perhaps given the father more to do in being in that crew versus these kids going off on their side mission and all that stuff and exploring a situation that we already knew hand and foot what was going to happen anyway. Yeah, they're going to discover, you know, Mechagodzilla and all this kind of stuff. That angle of the story we really didn't need. I think they could have actually, you know, could have cut that thing out entirely and the movie would have been fine. But, you know, going back, I got to say, I didn't hate the characters. I didn't hate them. I thought that some were kind of non-essential and unneeded, but I didn't hate them. You know, and I've seen a lot of these monster movie films, a lot. And my roundup of all the monster movie films that I've seen and characters and all of that is that for the most part, in monster films, characters are there to move the story along and give a human connection to what's going on. And I've seen some that are really good, like the original Gojira. The characters are really, really great. I've seen some where the characters, you know, pull you into the story. Godzilla, or is it Mothra versus Godzilla? The characters are great. But, you know, that's few and far between in terms of characters. For the most part, you don't really get great characters. But sometimes you do. Sometimes you don't. But, you know, I'm going to say that, you know, it would be nice to get compellingly interesting characters that you care about. But unfortunately, you know, you don't get that a whole lot in monster films. I did care about these characters. I cared. I really liked Gia. I liked her adopted mother. I liked the guy that used to work for Monarch that wrote the Hollow Earth book. I liked him. I mean, the characters were likable, so I can say that much about the characters. But at the end of the day, guys, the monsters are the stars. And I really felt like the film really focused on the monsters. And this is, you know, I got to say, you know, it's called Godzilla versus Kong. I got to say, this is a King Kong film. King Kong's the star. King Kong is the one focused on. And I never once felt like the humans hijacked the story from the monsters, as I felt in many of these films. And I think there was a pretty well-to-do balance, because when we weren't seeing King Kong, we were seeing Godzilla. And I really, you know, one of the things that also I felt like is that we needed to see a little bit more of Godzilla. It would have been nice to see more of him. But I at the end of the day, guys, I enjoyed the film. I really did. I enjoyed it. I would say that, you know, I'm one of the few fans that actually enjoyed King of the Monsters. That film's grown on me. Whereas at first, I kind of had a negative reaction to it. But as I watched it in further viewings, I got to like the film. And enjoy the movie. So I enjoyed this one. I enjoyed all the nods back to the original King Kong versus Godzilla from 1962. There's a scene, you know, and there's also a little bit of a nod to King Kong Escapes, where they put King Kong and took him to Antarctica. At least I think it was Antarctica and King Kong Escapes. So, you know, the nod to King Kong versus Godzilla, where they tie him up and they lift him out with all the helicopters. And there's even a scene where, you know, in the original film where Kong shoves a tree down Godzilla's throat. And this one, Kong shoves the axe down Godzilla's throat. And one of the scenes, too, that I thought was kind of interesting. And I'm assuming they were aware when they did this. But remember when in the original film when they dropped King Kong from the helicopters and he slid down the mountain and he kicked Godzilla. And then he gets back up. And right before he starts running up the mountain, he scratches his ass. And then in this film, there's a scene where Kong scratches his ass. And I was thinking, they must have did that just because they did it in 1962. His ass is still itching. I'm kidding. That's a different Godzilla and different Kong. But anyway, yeah. So I appreciate the nods to the other monster films and even some monster films that we weren't aware of. But one, two, what was that? I I would say also that in certain cases, the plot of this film actually meshed quite a bit with King Kong Escapes, because in King Kong Escapes, the scientist, evil scientist, wanted to kidnap him and make him go looking for this element and dig it out. In this film, the scientists want Kong to go looking for Hollow Earth and lead them to this energy source, just like they wanted him to do in King Kong Escapes. So there's a lot of fun to be had in this film. It was a lot of fun. I would say it was a lot of fun. Really a lot more fun the second time around. And then, you know, one thing, too, is that one of the biggest disappointments is this just really hurts, guys. You guys and girls, you don't know how much this hurts. But not being able to see this film on the big screen really freaking hurts, because I knew this would have been an experience to remember. And unfortunately, I saw it on television, and just you know, a giant monster film is no way. Watching it on television is no way to see a film like this. And I hate the fact that I had to watch this on the little screen, because this, you know, maybe one day I can catch it on the big screen. Maybe they'll reshow it or something. I hope, because I hated the fact, this fucking pandemic, man. I hate the fact that I could not watch this film. I had actual plans to see it on the big screen. We have like a couple of theaters open, but they were so sold out and shit, man. It's just, you couldn't get in, and I just did not want to risk it. But at any rate, great special effects. The special effects were really just, you know, top of the line in special effects. I mean, the monsters had scale, the special effects were just really, really gorgeous. These monsters never looked better. And the scaling was a lot better in certain instances when they did King of the Monsters. For the most part, the scale was really, really, really nice. It was nice to see monsters battle in the daylight. And even though I believe Kong fought Godzilla in Hong Kong and it was night, it was still easy to see. Everything looked good. And I enjoyed it. I really did. You know, a decent musical score. I wish that we had heard Godzilla's initial score like they did in King of the Monsters. I wanted to hear Godzilla's score. They didn't do it. Why do you have a Godzilla film without Godzilla's freaking score? Come on, man. You gotta have Godzilla's theme. But anyway, I enjoyed it, guys. I really did. It was a fun movie. I would say that Zack Snyder's Justice League, which I really did enjoy. I really did watch that film and had a lot of fun with it. I've watched it like 3 times now, is how much I enjoy it. Godzilla vs. Kong, another film that I really enjoyed. I had a fun time with this film. I think the name lives up to the hype. The monster battles are just top-notch, really great. Kong will never be a match for Godzilla, but he had that fighting spirit. You can't damn him for having the heart to take on such a formidable enemy. He did what he had to do. If he was going to die, he would have died the good death. The gorilla stood his ground, and at times he kicked ass, and you got to admire him, man. Because if I was Kong, I would have said, fuck this, I'm not fighting Godzilla, I'm fucking out of here, you humans are on your fucking own. So I would have left, man. But at the end of the day, really good film. Really good. Really good. I really enjoyed it. I really enjoyed it. And actually, I'm looking forward to watching it again. I had a good time with this movie. I really did. But, you know, guys, I'm a monster movie fan. I'm a fan that likes certain aspects of Godzilla's revenge. So, you know, maybe it don't take much for me to enjoy these movies. Although I got to say that, you know, thus far, if I rated the legendary MonsterVerse films from 1 being the best down to 4 being the least, I think there's been 4 films, I would say that in terms of the movies I enjoy the most, I would say, let's see, King Kong, or Godzilla vs. Kong is number 1. Kong Skull Island is number 2. King of the Monsters is number 3. And Godzilla 2014 is number 4. I'm really hoping that Legendary continues these movies. Now, what sucks about these movies, and this film in particular, is the fact that it was released during a pandemic. And I really feel like this movie would have been much more successful financially if it wasn't tied to all this, you know, this mess we're going through now, which really, you know, is bittersweet. But the film is doing pretty good as far as I've heard. And I want to see more of these monster films. I really do. I want to see films released with more of the classic monsters. I want to see Angulus. I want to see Baragon. I want to see, you know, Varan. I want to see a lot of the Toho classic monsters. And also what I'll say is the entire fight with Godzilla teaming up with Kong to battle Mechagodzilla. Pretty damn awesome. I gotta say, pretty awesome. Mechagodzilla was just wiping the fucking floor with Godzilla. And, you know, it's amazing to me. If you really think about how tough Mechagodzilla was in this film and all the punishment Godzilla took, and before Kong and Godzilla teamed up together and defeated Mechagodzilla, you gotta think, Godzilla's been through a lot of fucking shit, man. This is one tough-ass fucking monster. But at any rate, I'm going to get out of here, guys and girls. Good film. Enjoyed it. Had fun with it. I think at the end of the day, this is the kind of movie that you just have fun with. And for me, anyway, I think that it was a fun film. I had a good time with it. A worthy remake of the original film, King Kong versus Godzilla. And it's a film that, you know, at the end of the day, I can clearly see that it was made for fans of giant monster films and made by a fan of giant monster films. So in that regard, you know, they did a good job, a decent job. Anyway, thanks for watching, everybody. Take care of yourselves, and I will see you in the very next video.